Good afternoon. My name is Juan Fargas, and I'm from Houston, Texas. Quite a few familiar faces here. My question is regarding the issue of penalties. You know, in our communities, if a young man is experimenting with marijuana, coke, crack, whatever, you know, immediately they get picked up, they get fined, and most of the time they end up in jail. And a polluter, and they do pollute, you know, and they also have huge health implications on communities, and of course, you know, there's issues that are related to pollution where people even die from it, right? And we all know that. But why is it that they can get away with paying minimum fines and never serve jail time? I think that if we were in a position where the EPA would say, look, from now on, when you contaminate or you pollute communities in this amount, not only are you going to be have to pay a fine, but you're going to have to serve some time. And until we actually put our feet to the polluters, we're going to continue to have meetings like this that are generated with good intentions and good outcomes, you know. But we're not addressing the problem of prevention. We're just window dressing it, basically. So I would like to see policies be have actually criminal penalties versus, you know, just fines. That's one question. And the other question I would like to at least for our region in Region 6, is that I know you've had the regional administrator from this region, Region 4. I've gone to several of your meetings where you actually have a whole multitude of people come to your events such as this. And I would like to have something like this similar in Region 6. And the other thing I would like is that, you know, the Gulf, it covers 5 states. And there's a lot of issues that are going to be impacting low-income communities that are not being addressed when we talk about environmental justice communities. And that is the dredging of the Panama Canal is going to have a huge impact on all the ports along the Gulf. And also the Keystone Pipeline is basically tearing our country apart right now. The fracking industry is also creating a lot of issues in our communities. Those are serious issues that I think need to be addressed. And those are not only EJ issues, but they're national issues. And I think we need to address them at a national level. And despite the fact that, you know, there's not too much trust with our elected officials right now, they're home when they should be in Congress, right? But I think we need to start thinking bigger. Not that we're not, but at some point we're going to have to either unite ourselves as a nation to fight all this environmental injustice, not only in low-income communities, but throughout our nation and throughout the world. So I guess that's too many questions, but I'm glad that I'm here, and I'm glad to see that there's a lot of folks that I know here, and I hope to meet the others that I don't know. Thank you.
Thank you, Juan. Okay,
are
we going to
have meetings
like this in Region 6?
Yes.
Juan, we will have meetings like this in Region 6. Answer the question number 2. As far as the penalties go for polluters,
and this is kind of a joint answer, I think, between Ron and I. I think most of the statutes that allow EPA to assess penalties are civil ones. Obviously, there are various levels and types of environmental crimes, but it has to be a criminal action before you can start assessing any kind of time and that kind of thing. And so I think we both have CID offices that I used to be a prosecutor, so I use these these acronyms. Criminal Investigation Division that have several agents that are out on the ground all across the Gulf all across our regions, actually, to prosecute folks, companies as well as individuals who whose actions rise to the heightened level that a criminal case requires any prosecutor or the U.S. attorneys in this case to go forward in court. So we work pretty diligently to, in terms of the civil side, to look at the various penalties. And so I understand the dynamic that you can't set a penalty too low such that it's only a cost of doing business for a company. It's something that we were very familiar with in my old life as a prosecutor. We would look at either drug dealers or that kind of thing. So we understand that analogy, but we're also, our first and foremost goal is to make sure that we right the wrong that the company is doing and protect the community. And so there's a lot that goes into that assessment, and we're looking at ways to include input from the community prior to entering into the negotiations that ultimately yield the penalty. So we want to make sure we hear from the community in a timely fashion and then go forward from there. So it's not just a backroom decision without community input that you're presenting and asking for approval of after the fact. We're really trying to be more proactive in our processes.
Thank you. And Juan, was your third more of a comment with the pipeline and the fracking and the other issue? Did you want an answer to that question as well? Or that you said that these are national issues that should be addressed on a national level, but I wasn't sure if you wanted to.
You see, you don't want to do it.
Okay, go ahead.
No.
Me too.
No, okay, we're joking. It's the Keystone Pipeline, for instance, right now there's two issues. It's Region 6, because the pipeline is actually already being built from Oklahoma to the Gulf States, and then there's the international issue. And the impact that it's going to have on our nation, you know, as far as economics, as far as jobs, as far as pollution and all that stuff, is not going to help the Gulf Coast communities, which are already hotspots for environmental justice, you know, communities. And if environmental justice is a priority, how can we then sort of be hypocrites and allow an injustice like this to occur to communities that are going to be burdened with that pollution? We're going to be at the end of the tailpipe.
And I think everyone understands that's the case. I didn't know if you were expecting an answer, because I think everyone here on the panel understands that those issues do impact the Gulf and that they are national issues that should be understood nationally, that they would impact the Gulf. We understand, all of us on the Gulf, that that's the issue. But I didn't know if you wanted a particular question to someone on the panel regarding that.
How are you, in what position are you in to really assist communities like that? If you can't even handle an issue that is going to have national impacts, how can we feel secure that you're going to be able to do other things in our community? I guess that's the question.
All right, we're going to come back to you.
Sure, thank you.
Okay, next question.